today, the Honorable Maurice Jones. He is the Secretary of Commerce and Trade for the state of Virginia. So he has been appointed by Governor Cobbett in 2014, and his primary job is to make sure that we use Virginia's assets to solidify its position as a center for business and make it a prominent place to live and work. In addition to that, he also oversees the economic, community, and workforce development of the Commonwealth. He's also a Virginia native, and he served not only on the state level, he served at the Virginia Department of Social Services, as well as served as Deputy Chief of Staff to former Virginia Governor Mark Warner. He's also served on a national level, working for the U.S. Treasury Department, in addition to the Community Development and Financial Institution Fund, where he serves as a director during the Clinton administration. He's also received his Bachelor of Arts for Political Science at Hampton City College. And he also received his Master of Philosophy in International Relations from Oxford University under Rhodes Scholarship. And in addition to that, he has a degree. He has a doctorate from the University of Virginia. If you join me in welcoming the Honorable Maurice Jones.
How about that, right? So I came back, I called the company, I said, take your since 1972. Now, think about that. I bet you some of you weren't even born in 1972, right? You know who won a Super Bowl in 1972? Miami Dolphins. Who knows that? Are you a Dolphins fan? Oh, but you don't nail the Dolphins thing. But to give you a sense of it, so that's the last time, by the way, the Dolphins won. To give you another sense of how long ago that was, in 1972, I had an afro. Wait, that's not that one. Very low corporate tax rate. Not likely to go up, if anything. Probably is going to be decreased. And that helps us as we're trying to keep and recruit businesses and help leaders you're thinking about launching businesses. Because the cost of doing business is incredibly, incredibly important. The last asset I want to talk about actually is directly related to you, and it is what I think is Virginia's greatest asset. And that's its talent. I think Virginia has some of the best talent of any place, anywhere. So here's an example. A state in the union that has the biggest chunk per capita of employees with technology experience is Virginia. It is not Silicon Valley. 1 in 10 employee in Virginia has technology experience. We're in one of Virginia's great universities. Virginia has over 500,000 students studying in university right now. We confer somewhere around 80 to 85,000 different degrees each year. We have 23 community colleges scattered throughout the state. There's a community college within 30 miles of every resident of the state. We have national names like ECU, like the University of Richmond, like UVA, like Kansas City College, just to name a few. We have talent is really our strongest and most important asset. I'll come back to that at the end of this. But with these assets, the question becomes, how do we make sure we are making the investments, utilizing these assets in a way that keeps us resilient as a community? Now, the opposite side of the coin when it comes to assets are risk. Let me tell you about two risks that Virginia has that we have to constantly attend. Bless you. Who knows who the largest employer is in the state? Take a guess. Federal government. Which part of federal
government? Universities.
Department of Defense. Now, here's a tougher question. How did you know that, by the way? Have you heard me say that before?
Yes.
Oh.
Your entrepreneurial council.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's see if you remember this. Who's the second largest employer?
I don't
know. Walmart. All good guesses. They're all in the top 5 or 10. Walmart. Just looked at that sector has an overwhelming influence on the economic ups and downs of the Commonwealth. And thus, when the Defense Department is spending like it's been doing for the last 25 years, Virginia's economy cannot be touched. By far the best anywhere. When the Defense Department is contracted like it's been doing since about 2008, Virginia's economy feels it like no other economy anywhere in the country. So one of our biggest risks is today, as we chat, we depend too much on the public sector for our economic vibrancy and growth. One other risk we have, Virginia is more than one state. Newsflash, right? If you look at the growth that Virginia has been experiencing since we came out of the recession in 2010, the overwhelming bulk of that growth is where? Northern Virginia. And so the other great risk we have is too much dependence on one region for growth. So too much dependence on the public sector, too much dependence on one region. Those are the two big macro risks that a person in my job wakes up every day trying to address. You have to mitigate those risks. Eliminate those risks if you can. So as a result of that, we have prioritized trying to catalyze more private sector, non-public dependent growth throughout the Commonwealth. We're focusing on five things. One, infrastructure. And by infrastructure, yes, roads are definitely in that. But in addition to roads, we need better air service into the Richmond Airport. Right? More of an ability to go hop on an airplane and end up in LA without having to go through Dallas and Dubuque, Iowa. You're not going to go through Dubuque, I know. Mm-hmm. But you know what I mean? And do it at a price that's affordable. We have lost some economic development deals in the state because businesses have been wary of what it would cost to transport their executive team from a place like New York to here or Chicago to here. So we're working on regional, trying to increase regional airport traffic. Bless you.
Thank you.
Another piece of infrastructure, and this is becoming more and more important in the digital age, is broadband access. Well, broadband access today for business growth, for entrepreneurship, is tantamount to the need for oxygen for the region. You have to have it. In the rural parts of our state, 45% or more have inadequate access to broadband. So imagine if you're in your dorm room and the only way you can get on the internet is through dialing up. We probably don't know what dialing up is. I remember it well when I would hear that sound. And I'd wait 5 minutes. You don't have to worry about that. Well, in many parts of the rural parts of our state, that's what you're talking about. Hard to attract businesses, hard to help people grow businesses, hard to keep folks there who want to launch businesses when a basic necessity like broadband is not present. So we have been working with the private sector and placing millions of dollars in communities to help them get broadband. So infrastructure is a key ingredient. A second key ingredient is this business climate that we talked about. Keeping taxes low, keeping regulations lean and smart. In addition to that, you need incentives So we have financial and other incentives at the state and local level to help people launch businesses, to help people expand businesses, and guess what? To go to New Jersey and get all of their businesses. New York too, by the way. But we have financial incentives, among other things. It's a competition, like it or not. It's a competition. You have to be able to play. And so we have incentives as part of our environment. Third area that we've been focusing on pretty industriously is focusing on the right sectors. And this will be for you folks who are looking for where the jobs are. In Virginia, the growth sectors include cybersecurity, information technology, tourism, advanced manufacturing, agriculture still growing in some parts, biosciences or biotechnology. Those are some of the areas that are both growing, producing new jobs, and good wages, and present opportunities for launching businesses. So what we do at the state level is go after businesses that are in these spaces, or help people to launch businesses that are in these spaces. We want to be, if you will, on that wave of growth, and we want to try to catalyze it in these key sectors. We try to match these key sectors with the assets that we have. So if you've got the most digitally competent, if you will, or digitally adaptable workforce in the country, then you go after IT firms. So we go to India looking for IT firms. We go to Silicon Valley looking for IT firms. We go to New York and New Jersey and other places looking for IT firms. And we try to, if you will, see accelerators and incubators for IT firms right here in the state. Key sectors are important. The fourth area that I would mention, well, let's see, what's that for? Infrastructure sectors, business climate, talent. That's number four. We already talked about that. I want to actually, before I do talent, let me do this. Entrepreneurs. And let me say this about it. What you find, going back to where we started, what you are finding now is that the companies that are producing the most jobs right now across the country are either startups or early stage companies.
Woohoo!
It's not our larger companies. Our larger companies are continuing to go through what would be called a right sizing journey. Right? Some people would say that. But our larger companies are still right-sizing. The bulk of, I looked at a statistic the other day, there were a million new jobs created by large firms in the country last year. There were 3 million new jobs created by startups and those that are 3 years or younger. So we have an interest in Virginia in making sure that we invest in business creation. And one of the things we did last year was we had a business plan competition. We put $1 million aside as a pool. We invited entrepreneurs to come in and give us ideas for a business plan for launching businesses in the energy sector and the biosciences. Went through 2 or 3 levels of judging, and we weeded it down to about 7 prospective companies, who then came before us and did a pitch or participated in a pitch contest. And then we chose 5 winners, and we invested $250,000 in each one of those companies. We're doing the same thing in smaller communities throughout the Commonwealth. with the goal being to sustain and get in more business reach. Last area is the talent area. We're focusing on getting more folks into our universities, getting our overhauling in our high schools, getting more folks into and out of our universities, graduating more people in the STEM fields. But I want to pause and tell you about an area that that is probably as critical as any in the talent preparation arena. And that is, we think we're going to need a million 500,000 new jobs in Virginia between now and 2030. 500,000 of those will be net new jobs, we think, and the other 1 million will be jobs that will become available because people are retired, mostly. Well, according to our estimates, 50, now, don't be depressed by this one, but 50 to 65% of those jobs will not be four-year degrees. But they will need talent that gets a good K-12 preparation, and talent that gets a post-secondary credential in a key area. So I was a BA in political science. Recently I compared the market value of what one would pay a BA in political science to what one would pay a person who had an American Welding Society certification. Guess what? The BA in political science did not make half of what, at the entry level, the certification in welding. So guess what I'm doing today? I wanted that welding class. The point is, where we are really focusing a lot of our efforts in the talent preparation arena is getting more of our folks certified in the trades. Welding, machinists, coders, mechanics, truck drivers. We need 7 of those folks for every one we have in hand. And we have to make sure that in addition to producing folks who are at the managerial level, if you will, we're producing folks who can keep our machines running, who can work with the robots, who can fix the robots, who can code, who can read the code. That is for us as critical as anything. So we're placing millions of dollars into our workforce development system to get at this trades and technical competency. If we do well in that area, we'll have a valuable and best prepared workforce. If we don't have balance there, we'll be in trouble. Here's good news. We are experiencing great growth all across the state. We've got a 4.1% unemployment rate. We've added 96,503 jobs in just a year, 135,000 jobs in a 2-year span. We've had 23 consecutive months of year-over-year growth. We're in a good place. We can't exhale. We've got to continue to invest in the talent, which is another one asset we have in order to keep going. Now, as far as the talent goes, you are the talent. There are 2 or 3 things that I want to share with you or leave with you to think about, and then I'll try to get out of the way. As I think about the preparation that I would advise you to invest in as you're looking at your future, there are 2 or 3 things that I would comment on. First, the young lady before me talked about the fact that what is most important for her business was to be able to differentiate from all the competition, right? That's a branding exercise, as well as substantive. I would submit to you that for you as individuals, that is also going to be your most important thing to think about. What is it about you that's different from every other talent individual that I interview? You're going to need to think about that, answer to that, and develop that for yourself. You will have a brand as well. And the question is, what will your brand be? And you will be the architect, the principal architect of your brand. Do you want your brand to be that you work harder than everybody else? Do you want your brand to be that you know more about a particular IT application than everybody else? Whatever it is, you need to think about that and invest in it now. Second thing, and I think this is related to the first, and if I had to prioritize, I would put this first. You will need to, if you haven't already, think about what your core values are. What are those things that, for you, if someone asks you to violate them, you will walk away from the job rather than compromise your values? This is the one that I would tell you to think about. This is the one that I will tell you to always visit and revisit for yourself. You're going to need your own set of core values. You're going to need those things to guide you to make the decisions that you want to make to continue to be the person you want to be no matter where you are. Honesty. Integrity. Hard work. Whatever it is you're going to need, you will be, if you live long enough, and if it hasn't happened already, you will be confronted with situations where you will be asked to make decisions that are consistent with your core values. You're going to need strong core values to know what decision to make. And that will be what will really separate you at the end of the day. When I think about, I used to run a newspaper business, when I think about the employees that for me were the ones I would go to first, it was not necessarily the people who had the greatest talent in a particular area. It was somebody whose word I knew I could accept. It was somebody who I knew would work as hard as he or she could to get the job done. It was somebody that I knew could work well with other teammates. Those were the things that were, for me, the most important ingredients of my employees, not necessarily how smart they were. And those are the lasting assets. There will always be somebody who's smarter than you that you did something. But the core values piece, that's really who you are. And that's what people will remember when they're looking. I will tell you, that's the one. When you're going into business for yourself, going on to further schooling, going into the marketplace, that's the muscle that will be the most important. There are resources everywhere to be helpful to you. There are resources in a place like this. There are resources that we have at the state level. I wish you well. I look forward to following your progress, and thank you for letting me do it.
give you a quick overview about the rest of the program here. A bit of bio for Luis. He's currently working at a top-rated accelerator called Lighthouse Labs. He has operations support there, and it's just freelancing. He helps countless companies in their business development on the side, which is pretty cool. And he, at Lighthouse Labs, he does operations for internship team projects. So if you can just give 5 minutes to Luis, and he'll tell you about the next steps for the rest of the program. Thank you.
We should bring those 7,000 students, especially the health of all.